monstrous eyes and ears, straining, watching, waiting. Inside the control station, a team of specialists with ultra-sensitive electronic equipment, ready to probe the vast reaches of the sky. These men are waiting for the climax of a dramatic experiment they've been working on for many months in collaboration with the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. An experiment known by its code name as Project Echo. Men like Luke Lowry here, Dick Klon, Bill Snell, project engineer, all scientists with the Bell Telephone Laboratories. In a few minutes, if things go right, Home Bell will communicate by telephone. Microwave transmitters carry telephone calls over barren and open spaces. These systems will always serve us well, but today, as scientists look ahead, they foresee great gaps in our worldwide communications unless more and different systems can be devised. For instance, we would like to see live television programs, history in the making, from all over the world. But TV broadcasting presents a special problem. One TV channel requires the space of almost 1,000 telephone signals. This requirement is simply too expensive for our present system. And even if this problem could be met today, what about tomorrow? For many years now, Bell Laboratory scientists have been looking at empty satellites for communication. We are already capable of building a satellite equipped with operating receivers and transmitters, which could be made to operate at a much greater height than a simple reflective balloon like that. worldwide communication system of satellites like this has already been outlined by the Bell system. The plan envisions several strings of equipped satellites, altogether about 50 of them, orbiting at a height of about 3,000 miles. As the one you were using moved out of range, you would switch to the next one coming along, and so on. And if you wanted to send, say, a telephone message or a television program, you primarily are not covered by any single satellite. The signals might be bounced from transmitter to satellite, back to Earth, up to a second satellite, and down to the destination. That way, you could maintain continuous transmission of telephone calls and television programs to various parts of the Earth. But scientists have conjectured even far beyond this. Perhaps, someday, it will be possible and worthwhile to put up a precisely positioned satellite 22,300 miles out, which at that distance would revolve in step with the Earth and would seem always to hang in the same place in the sky. If it became possible to put three such satellites in orbit, together they could cover the Earth. Through space, the control center maintains communication with it, checks its position, and automatically sends any necessary steering orders to keep it on its predetermined path. This guidance system was designed by Bell scientists, the same system that meets the precise target demands of the Titan intercontinental ballistic missile. Its job here is to put the Echo satellite in orbit with pinpoint accuracy. Will it? That is the question these men ask themselves as they finish monitoring the guided portion of the missile's flight. And will the balloon, squeezed into a 26-inch sphere, release okay? Will it inflate properly, or burst into fragments? scientific information acquired from this and other experiments in its program of space exploration. It really sounds good here, Walt. Fine, Bill. And so the first spoken word from man through space to his own satellite and back to man again is the voice of the President of the United States. And as the satellite sweeps swiftly out of range, further transmission must wait for another passage. Now, sometime later, as the balloon again passes over America, the same scientists try the first telephone conversation ever bounced from a man-made satellite.
You can fire up the transmitter.
Right. Intercontinental communication system.